This media has been made available by Mosaic Boston Church. If you'd like to check out more resources, learn about Mosaic Boston in our neighborhood churches, or donate to this ministry, please visit mosaicboston.com.
Good morning, welcome to Mosaic Church. My name is Jan, one of the pastors here, along with Pastor Shane and Pastor Andy. If you're new or visiting, welcome. We're so glad you're here. We'd love to connect with you. We do that through the connection card, either the physical one that you can get in the back or the virtual one you can get in the app, or you can get that on the website. One quick announcement. Starting today, for the next three Sundays, we're going to have a prayer service at 5 p.m. here. And the format is we'll have prayer, we'll have a little worship, we'll have about a 20-minute sermon from a brother in the congregation, member of the church, pursuing the call of Christ to vocational ministry. And then after that, we'll do some more prayer and some more worship. And we're doing this in particular to prepare our hearts in the season of Lent for Good Friday and then for Easter. Good Friday is April 2nd. We have a service here. And then Easter is April 4th. We have three services. Why three services? To make room for the friends that you are planning to invite. Easter is a great opportunity to invite people who don't go to church to come with you. People understand Easter is kind of a big deal. It's getting nice out. You take them out to service. You take them out to brunch. You share the gospel. Well, I'll share the gospel with them here. You share the gospel with them there. They get saved and they win. Jesus wins. We all win. Praise God. So that's the plan for the 4th of April. With that said, would you please pray with me over the preaching of God's holy word? Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are a good Father. And despite the fact that we, your creation, rebelled against you, you did not leave us in our sins, and you sent Jesus Christ, your Son, your beloved Son. Jesus, we thank you that you came, that you lived a perfect life, the life that we would not, could not live, and then you went to the cross to die in our place for our rebellion, for our law-breaking, for our selfishness, our idolatry. And Jesus, you bore the wrath of God the Father on the cross so that we would not have to. By grace through faith, you provide a way for us to be invited into the family of God, to be adopted as sons and daughters. That's not something that we are entitled to, but it is something that we can be gifted. And all we have to do is repent of sin and trust in Jesus Christ, and we can be sons and daughters of God the Father. And once we are, Lord, I pray that you strengthen our faith in your sovereignty, that you are a great God and you are a good God, that you can do all things and that you love us so much so that you provide for all of our needs. And we thank you, Holy Spirit, that you, the third person of the Trinity, that you're with us today and that you long to draw us closer into the heart of the Trinity. You want us to know the greatness and the goodness of God and to trust in him. Lord, we thank you for the gift of faith. Holy Spirit, we thank you for giving us that faith, and we pray that you strengthen it, that you enlarge it, that you stretch it, that you give us a great vision of God, that we believe in a great God, and that you give us a great faith in that great God, a faith that gives us an ironclad resolve, resilience in life, that nothing can shake us, nothing can pluck us out of the hand of God the Father. Therefore, from that perspective, let us look at all of our problems, all of our anxieties, of all of our stress. We don't need to hold on to those. We can cast our burdens upon you because you care for us. Teach us how to do that practically. Today, Holy Spirit, we invite you into this place. Enlighten our minds, illuminate our minds, and draw us closer to yourself. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. If you are new, we are going through the Sermon on the Mount, which is the greatest sermon ever preached by the greatest preacher who ever preached, that's Jesus Christ. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus isn't telling us how we can enter into a relationship with God the Father. He's not telling us how can we live a life that is acceptable to God the Father. He's not saying this is how you justify yourself. He's not saying this is what you do to get saved. He's saying you can't do anything to get saved. That's why Jesus came. That's why God became incarnate. He became one of us. However, you can be saved by grace through faith, by repenting of sin and trusting in Jesus Christ, acknowledging your spiritual bankruptcy, that we need grace, we need to be forgiven. And from this posture of neediness, we come to God, and by grace through faith, we become children of God the Father. This is one of the great miracles of Christianity. We can be adopted as children into the family of God. Therefore, We don't need to be anxious about the material things of life. God the Father, who's provided for our greatest need on the cross through Jesus Christ, will also with that give us all things that we need. From that perspective, Jesus Christ last week talked about money and possessions, and he says, do not lay up for yourself treasures on earth. Instead, use the treasures on earth to lay up treasures in heaven. It's all from a spiritual perspective. And what Jesus is saying is focus on prioritizing the right things, making the main thing the main thing, and a failure to view riches and possessions and stuff from a proper eternal perspective, what it does is promotes anxiety. I hope you enjoyed the weather this week. We had one day in the 70s, praise God. I hope you enjoyed it, because here's the thing about the weather in Boston. Fall is nice. Winter is long. Spring is about 3 days. I think our spring was last week. And one of the things about Boston weather is out of nowhere, it can start snowing again this time of the year. And my former apartment, my wife and I, and we had our two first daughters there in that apartment. It was on Lanark Road, Cleveland Circle, one-way street, beautiful place. It was on the second floor. And one of the things that we loved most about that place is there was a magnolia tree right outside of our window. And we loved it. And when it would bloom in the spring, there would be white and purple flowers, just gorgeous. And the aroma would come into our apartment, would waft in, and it was incredible. And one time, it was already blooming one spring, and then all of a sudden, we get snow, and it was a nasty kind of snow, the wet snow. And this wet snow just descended upon our beautiful magnolia tree, and the beautiful branches started drooping and crackling and breaking. And it broke our hearts, so actually I went and grabbed my shovel and started cleaning it off. And as you clean off the snow, you see the branches just breathe a sigh of relief, so to speak, from the burden as the burden's alleviated. And I like that image as an illustration for stress upon us, especially in this past year. It's been a year since the start of the pandemic. This past year, you see just the weight and the burden, the anxiety, the stress on people almost physically weighing down on them like cinder blocks. So the question before us today is, what are we anxious about? What are we stressed out about? Is it your health? Where's the economy going? Is it politics? Is it more personal things like looks or weight or health or hair or clothes, school, grades, GPA, school loans, or perhaps it's career and progressing up the ladder in your job, or perhaps it's relationships, meeting the one, or in marriage, or raising children, how to raise children in a godless place. And all of this comes down to fear. Fear of what? Well, fear of the future. What is to come? And we as Christians, we entrust God with our past. God, forgive me of all my sins. And we perhaps entrust God with our present. God, you have provided for today, and we thank you for that. But we have such a hard time entrusting God with the future. And what Jesus wants us to do today as we meditate upon this text is to know that everyone fears. And we have a choice to make when we fear. Are we going to hold on to that fear and let it grow, or are we going to battle that fear with faith? And the way that you battle fear of the future is faith in the Father. God loves you. He's a good God. He's a good Father, and he's a great Father, that he has the power to help, and he will, because he loves you. So today we're going to look at Matthew 6, 25 through 34. Matthew 6, 25 through 34. Would you look at the text with me? Therefore, I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow, nor reap, nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? Which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life? And why are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon, in all his glory, was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is alive and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? Therefore, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek after these things. And your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Therefore, do not be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will be anxious for itself. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. This is the reading of God's holy, inerrant, infallible, authoritative word. May he write these eternal truths upon our hearts. 3 points to frame up our time. First, do not be anxious. Second, focus on your Father. And third, seek first the kingdom. Do not be anxious. That this is what Jesus tells us in verse 25 and verse 31. Do not be anxious, he says in verse 25, about your life. And then he talks about the physical things. He's talking about food, drink, clothing, etc. First thing you got to point out is there's different kinds of anxiety. There's something that Jesus is talking about here and something that is beyond the scope of this text. Different kinds of anxiety. There's the first one is a God-given emotional response to danger that we feel, where we experience fight or flight. Pastor Shane in a sermon one time said, on the mean streets of Boston, once in a while, you will get attacked by turkeys, which is true. If you get attacked by turkeys on the mean streets of Boston, you better run. Don't fight them. They will win every time. There's a stress. There's adrenaline that comes up so that you make the right decisions. That's one type of anxiety. There's another type of anxiety, which is just a disordered physiological response. It could be clinical anxiety or chronic condition. Soldiers coming back from war experience something along these lines. First responders are victims of abuse. That's not what he's talking about here. There's also anxiety that's a natural consequence of sin, perhaps living a sinful pattern of life that gets you in a situation where there is an anxiety, and that anxiety is given. It's a God-given gift for you to get out of the situation you're in. So if you gamble and you gamble everything away and you're in debt, there's an anxiety about that, and there should be. That's not what Jesus is talking about here. He's talking about the sinful responses to God's providential care over the physical matters of our basic physical needs in life. Jesus isn't saying that we can shirk our responsibility and not care for ourselves, not care to provide for ourselves, for those in our lives, and to be generous for others. He expects his people to work hard and to provide for their own needs and have enough to share with others. We talked about that last week. Some Christians have taken these words and they've used them to justify laziness or slothfulness. I had an uncle who used this text to justify racking up credit card debt. He's like, I don't have to worry. Do not be anxious about anything. I'll pay my minimum amount, whatever, et cetera. And then when they're like, what are you going to do? He's like, I don't have to worry about anything because Jesus is coming back soon. That's not what Jesus is talking about, not to use this as an excuse. Jesus isn't saying don't plan. Jesus gives the parable of the builder who builds a tower, and the foolish builder does not sit down beforehand and calculate how much he needs to complete the tower, or the foolish general who does not sit down and look at his firepower and his manpower. Can he take on that army? No, we are to plan. What Jesus is getting at is the difference between a caring concern and fixation. Fixation upon the things of life, an obsession about possessions in life. And we are to also plan to be generous. James talks about a situation where a person who is hungry or a person who's lacking clothing comes into the church community. And Jesus talks about hypocrites who say, do not be anxious, be clothed, be filled, trust in the Lord, without meeting the practical needs. No, that's not what Jesus is talking about, not that irresponsible spirituality. What he is talking about is, despite the problems we have in life, he's not saying we're not going to have problems in life. He's saying, despite the problems in life, you don't need to be consumed by worry, even in the midst of problems. And the difference between concern and anxiety is this. Concern is you have an issue, you have a situation, and you can do something about it. So do that. That's concern. Anxiety is when you have a situation that you have zero control over, and instead of entrusting it to God, You're just focused on this. Someone said that anxiety is having a conversation with yourself about things that you can't change. And you're just having that conversation over and over. Robert Frost said more people die from worry than from work because more people worry than work. Jesus calls us to work hard, but there are things that we cannot control. Therefore, he says, give those things up to God. And it's a question about attitudes, about priority, and we'll get into that. Twice he gives us the imperative of do not be anxious in verse 25, verse 31. Six times the word anxious or anxiety is used in this text. The Greek word for do not be anxious or to be anxious is merimnao, and the noun from that verb is merimna. And Jesus often talks about this care for physical things. When it's made a priority in life, it does have a propensity to pull us away from the more important things in life, which is the spiritual things. Matthew 13, 22, the parable of the sower. As for what was sown among thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares, merimna, of the world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and it proves unfruitful. This is when you're reading God's word. This is when you're hearing God's word proclaimed. And you're thinking about the physical things in life. And the word doesn't take root. Or Luke 21, 34, talking about the second coming. But watch yourselves, lest your hearts be weighed down with dissipation and drunkenness and cares, merimna, of this life. And that day come upon you suddenly like a trap. Fog, if you look at fog, that blanket, say seven blocks of a city, it can be 100 feet deep. If you take all of that fog and you turn it into water, it will barely fill one glass. From an internal perspective, God sees the water, we see the fog. And God wants us to see through the fog and see all of our anxiety, all of our problems from a sovereign perspective, that God is sovereign. Worry is foolish on so many levels. It's not just foolish, it's sinful. It's a commandment, thou shalt not be anxious, do not be anxious. The commandment that's repeated more than any other command in the scripture is, do not fear. Meaning this is a sin. Sometimes anxiety and stress and worry and fear is a sin that needs to be repented of. We can be orthodox in our heads, but heretics in our hearts. So not only is it a sin, it's also foolish. Worry never solved a problem, never dried a tear. Anxiety never lifted a burden, never removed an obstacle. It never made bad things good and good things better. When the Lord is at hand, if you're a child of God and God is with you, you're in his hand. When the Lord is at hand, as Philippians 4, 5, and 6 says, the Lord is at hand, do not be anxious about anything. Anything. Worry kills joy. Worry causes stress. Worry results in our assuming the responsibility that God does not have for us. Don't play God. That's what worry does. We can dishonor God with covetousness about possessions. And we can also dishonor God with worry, over anxiety about money, about possessions. So instead of being anxious, do not be anxious. Instead of seeking and focusing on the material things, we are to change our priority, change our perspective, and seek the Father, seek the eternal things. Any parent knows that when a child is holding on, fixated on an object that is harmful, with every one of my kids, I learned this, like if they pick up some trash as little babies, pick up some trash from the ground, they want to eat, or pick up a gum from the ground and they want to chew it. In my immaturity, in my lack of experience as a father with my first kids, I would just grab that thing, and then the next step is they're like, bam, there's a breakdown, and then you got to deal with that. The wise parent, the prudent parent, the experienced parent plays four-dimensional chess with their children. I know exactly what's going to happen. Now, if I take this chewed up piece of gum from you, I need to replace it really quickly. The sleight of hand really quickly with something else, maybe a good piece of gum. You got to change the perspective. And this is exactly what Jesus is doing in this text. He understands that if he just says, do not be anxious, do not be worried, and he leaves us in the vacuum, now we begin to worry about not worrying, becoming anxious about not being anxious or becoming stressful about not being stressed. He says, no, change the perspective. From stress, from stuff, from things, from the temporal, from the material to the eternal, to your Father. And your heavenly Father will take care of your food. That's verse 25. Therefore, I tell you, not be anxious about your life, what you will eat, what you will drink, nor about your body, what you put on. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Don't be anxious. The present imperative, constant, continuous action. You got to preach this to yourself on a daily basis. What am I worried about today? Am I worried about food today? Am I worried about clothing today? Am I worried about housing today? Am I worried about my future today? What am I worried about? And Jesus gives a rhetorical question here. Isn't life more than food? It's a rhetorical question that we can ask ourselves. Oh, dear soul, my soul, is not life more than food? Is not life more than housing? Is not life more than finances? Of course. Of course, life needs these things, but life is so much more than these things. And if you say, what do you mean if I don't focus on the physical, if I don't provide for myself by focusing on the physical, who will? Who will focus on those things? And Jesus' answer is the Father. Your heavenly Father, when you focus on what he calls you to focus on, he will provide everything else. Matthew 6:26, look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? I love this verse for many reasons. One is we have a quick theology of environmentalism or ecology here, of creation, of the animal order, the animal kingdom, so to speak. And we live in a day and age where a lot of people hold a worldview that humans are equal in value to animals. This just isn't true. From God's perspective, there is a hierarchy, and creation, the earth, is not more than human beings. We are to care for creation, of course, but we are to care more for human beings. Are you not of more value than birds? Are you not of more value than dogs? Are you not more value than cats or any animal? Jesus says, of course. That you are valuable to God. Why? Because God created you in his image, not anyone else. God created, not any animal is created in the image of God. Therefore, he talks about these birds who don't, they don't farm, they don't store, they don't plant crops or store them or harvest them. Yet your heavenly Father feeds, not their heavenly Father. God does not claim to be father of animals. God does not claim to be father of birds. He does claim to be father of adopted children through Jesus Christ. And here we get into something that's really, really important. Really, 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 this is crucial. A lot of people think that just by virtue of existence, I am a child of God. That's not true. That's not true. We are all creation of God. God is our creator. But we become children of God the Father through adoption, through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is our older brother. He has provided a way for us to become adopted by grace through faith. So on the one hand, we hear this and we're so blessed, we're so encouraged, we're so comforted by this text that your heavenly Father provides for you, therefore you don't have to worry about it. If you're a Christian, if you are a child of God, if you are not a child of God, or you're not sure, you should be anxious. You should be anxious about your future. Jesus here is saying, don't sweat the small stuff. He's not saying, don't sweat the soul stuff. We are to ask ourselves, what is my position with God? Am I a child of God? And if you're not sure, the way you become sure is by repenting of your sin and trusting in Jesus Christ, in his provision for us to become adopted into the family of God. Trusting that on the cross, Jesus Christ met our greatest need, which is he absorbed the wrath of God that we deserve for our rebellion, for our law breaking, for our idolatry, for our fixation with the physical at the expense of worshiping, glorifying him. When you repent, when you trust, now you become an adopted child of God. Therefore, you don't need to be worried. So this only applies to Christians. And then once you're a Christian, God does care for his children. God will take care of your life. That's verse 27. Which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life? What a fascinating phrase. What's the point of worrying? Can you add an hour to your life? Can you add a minute to your life? Can you add a second to your life? What he's saying is worry does not lengthen life. It doesn't improve the quality of life. And in some senses, worry, and this is what doctors tell us, worry can actually shorten life. But from God's perspective, God has predestined the moment of conception. He's predestined the moment of birth. He's also predestined the moment of death. And that sovereignty, that God is sovereign over every single minute of our lives. Jesus uses that grounding, that foundation to build up our faith in God. Job 14:5, since his days are determined and the number of his months is with you and you have appointed his limits that he cannot pass. There is a moment that you will not pass, that I will not pass. I remember at a funeral, this was Tanya's uncle died, and he died fairly young. And we were at a funeral where a seasoned pastor got up, and the pastor was in his 90s. I remember he preached a sermon on this text. It was the first time I had ever heard this text. He was talking about the fact that no matter what you do, there's nothing you can do in lengthening, but no matter what you do, every single second of every single person's life is predetermined. It's fixed. On the one hand, that should cause trepidation in us that if you're not a child of God, that you are to be reconciled with God so that your eternity is secure and you go to heaven. On the other hand, there's incredible peace that comes, fills your heart. A peace that God has everything under his control. God has created me for a purpose. He's designed me in a particular way. He has trained me. He's given me talents, given me opportunities. He's filled me with the Holy Spirit and anointed me to fulfill a purpose. The very second that purpose is fulfilled, he's taking me home. And that should not be, for the Christian, that takes all the burden off. This is why St. Paul says, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. Psalm 139:16, your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there was none of them. If you journal, you write about things that happened today. God has a journal, a book for every single one of us, which every single day, every single second of every single day is outlined. He's sovereign. Therefore, worry is a sign that we don't adequately know how sovereign he is, how everything is under his control, or we just don't trust him, or we have not yielded to him. There's a pride that gets in the way where we don't want to humble ourselves before him. We get gripped with anxiety and we take our lives out of the Father's hand and try to grasp our lives with our own hands. Jesus says, don't do that. God will take care of our clothing, Matthew 6:28 through 30. And why are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon, all his glory, was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is alive and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? I preached a sermon this morning, and my wife goes to the first service, and she says, of course you don't have to worry about clothing. I buy all your clothing. That's true. Praise God. I don't have to worry. He says, why are we worried? God will provide. He will provide food. He will provide clothing. Many of us are fixated with clothing too much so. What's the size of the clothing apparel industry in the U.S.? $368 billion a year. What's the size of the secondhand or resale market? $28 billion. And whenever I think about clothing, because I live in the city, I'm like, where do people store all their stuff? Well, then what's the size of the storage industry in the U.S.? $90 billion, where people rent space to put their extra stuff in that they don't look at. And Jesus says, we shouldn't be preoccupied. And the reason why we are preoccupied, and this is really how Jesus lands this section, he says, oh, you of little faith. God clothes Solomon, and Solomon, in all his proverbial opulence, doesn't come close to the beauty of the flowers of the field. Oh, you of little faith, aren't you more valuable than flowers? Of course you are. And this is a phrase that is used often in Matthew four times outside of this text, this phrase of little faith. It's used in Matthew 8:26, where Jesus Christ is in the boat with the disciples, and there's a storm in the Sea of Galilee. Jesus is sleeping. The disciples wake him up, and they say, don't you care about us? Jesus calms the storm, rebukes it, and then he says, oh, you of little faith. Oh, you of little faith. Why are you so afraid? We see this text when Peter's walking on water. He's focusing on Jesus. And as he's focused on Jesus, walking on water, and then he starts getting fixated on the waves and the wind, all of a sudden he starts drowning. Jesus says, oh, you have little faith. We see this when Jesus provides bread miraculously in chapter 16, where he casts out a demon out of a little boy. He tells the disciples, oh, you have little faith. So what he's saying is the opposite of anxiety is faith. The opposite of anxiety is faith. The opposite of anxiety is not ungrounded optimism, where everything will work out. Some people have that, where it's just like everything will work out. Based on what? He says, no. It's not this unfounded optimism. It's faith. It's faith that's grounded in God. So in a sense, worry is a lack of faith in God. So in a sense, worry is practical atheism, where you can believe in God, but practically you don't. It could be that, or it could be deism, where you don't believe in a God that cares, or it could be finite theism, which you just don't believe that God is powerful enough to help. The opposite of anxiety is faith, and Jesus says, we become children of God by grace through faith. Faith is a gift. In the same way, forgiveness is a gift, faith is a gift, and that gift needs to be trained up. That gift needs to be fanned into flame. And the way that our faith is fanned into flame, number one, is we need a greater vision of God. Some of us have a big faith in a little God, and that's not helpful. I'd rather have a little faith in a big God. The bigger your vision of God, that God is transcendent, that God is absolutely in control of everything, that all things are held together in him. He's a big God. And then that little faith in a big God begins to grow. And when you test that faith, when you take that faith and you put it in a position where there's weight and burden upon that faith, it begins to grow with weights and with reps. So do you believe in a God who's bigger than your biggest problems? George Mueller, the great prayer warrior and minister of God, says the beginning of worry is the end of faith, and the beginning of faith is the end of worry. Mark 5:36, Jesus says, do not fear, only believe. That's how you counter fear. God will take care of your needs as well. Verse 31, therefore, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek after these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. He says this anxiety, this stress, this worry, it puts us Christians on the level of unbelievers. The unbelievers who have a laser beam focus on the physical things in life, that's their primary concern. The Gentiles made these things the point of life. That's why it's become idolatrous. So they believe in these things. And here Jesus is assuming that everybody believes in something. We can't not believe. We can't live our lives without belief, without faith. Every time you get an Uber, you believe, you're entrusting yourself to that driver. Every time you get in a plane, that pilot, you're entrusting yourself to the pilot, to the plane. Every single time you go to a restaurant and you eat a meal, you're trusting that this meal isn't going to kill you. There's faith involved. And he's saying we all exercise faith. The Gentiles believe in stuff or themselves. We are not to believe in things, money, possessions, not even ourselves. Don't entrust yourself to yourself. We need to entrust ourselves to someone greater than that's our Heavenly Father. He says, and your Heavenly Father knows you need them all. Your Heavenly Father, and you just break this up with every phrase, yours. He's my Father. He's my Father. He knows me. I am his. My name is graven on his hands. He's my Heavenly Father. He's the sovereign God of the universe. He's my Heavenly Father. He's my Abba. He sees me, knows me in a most tender and intimate way. He knows, your Heavenly Father knows, he sees, he cares, he's not ignorant, he's not indifferent. Your Heavenly Father knows you need them. He knows our precise needs. So what he's saying here is, don't live like the Gentiles, because practically they live like orphans. They live like spiritual orphans. who, if they don't provide for themselves, no one will. Instead, live like children of God the Father, children of the King. Experience this royal freedom. And I'm not talking about just the financial privileges of having God as your Father. I'm talking about the greater riches, the joy, the freedom, the satisfaction that are ours in Christ Jesus. There's two ways to ask God or think about God providing for us. The first way is riddled with anxiety. God, will you help me? God, will you help me? It's almost assumed in that, in this question, that he will not. God, do you care? There's a frustration, there's despair, there's an anxiety of will God help? The other question is, how will God help? As a child of God, this is how we ask. I know God will provide. He always has, he always will. Now, I'm just anticipating eagerly, joyfully, I'm anticipating. I can't wait to find out how he will provide for my need. Completely different mindset about the future that changes the way that you live through the present. And finally, seek first the kingdom. So don't be anxious. Seek the Father, the face of the Father. Seek your attention to the Father. And seek first the kingdom. Seek first the kingdom. This is Matthew 6:33. But seek first the kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Seek first. This is the priority. Seek this first before anything else. So before you seek food and clothing, seek first the Father and his kingdom and his righteousness. Practically speaking, first thing you do when you wake up, seek first the kingdom. Seek first the King and his kingdom and his righteousness. This is you, scripture, prayer, before coffee. No, just kidding. Together with coffee, concurrently with coffee. We're not extremists. With coffee, scripture, prayer, seeking for, but it is a priority. It's, there's something special about waking up and saying, you know, as a priority, I'm going to spend time seeking the face of God my Father. Seek first. And it does take faith. Especially the more things you have to do, the more faith it takes that day to seek the kingdom, the King, the kingdom, and his righteousness. The only way to do this is to live by faith and not by sight. Faith knows that worldly possessions and things and pleasures, they're all temporary. They crowd out a love and service of God in a person's life. Faith also knows that it need not worry about the stuff of life because the Heavenly Father will provide. So basically, there's two directions of life, two directions of seeking. You can seek for yourself, for your kingdom, or seek God and his kingdom. The Greek word for seek here is zeteo, and it's used elsewhere. Talk about a hunter who's hunting not for fun, not for sport, but for food to sustain himself and his family. He's focused with all senses. He's seeking this thing, bow and arrow ready. We are to seek like that. How do we overcome this worry and this hold that possessions have upon us, a fixation? The way we overcome, just practically speaking, is reminding ourselves of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that God in Christ at the cross met our greatest need. All of our debts were paid off, our greatest need of being reconciled with God the Father, it was handled. So therefore, we can trust in him. He's met our greatest need. Obviously, he'll take care of our lesser needs. And when the gospel is at the center of everything in your life, you know that God is your greatest treasure, that Jesus Christ is your greatest treasure. There's nothing remotely close, and therefore, everything else can be in service to God. A lot of people ask, how do you know that Christianity is true as opposed to other religion? One of my favorite apologetics is to point out how Christianity grew. Islam grew by the sword. It's a historical fact, by force. Christianity grew despite the sword, despite persecution. Of the first apostles, every single one of them died for their faith, except for John, who was exiled in Patmos. But every single one of them, as eyewitnesses of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, they went to the death with that testimony. And then the early church was persecuted by Nero, by the Caesars, for centuries persecuted for the faith. And the blood of the martyrs was the seed of the church. And so much so that Christianity grew by 40% per decade, so much so that by the fourth century, when Constantine is in power, he's looking at his empire and he wants to consolidate it, and he decides to convert to Christianity, consolidate his empire. We don't know if he became a Christian. We think his historians think his wife did. But despite the sword, Christians knew that this was true because of the work of the Holy Spirit in their life by the gospel. So Hebrews 10:32 through 34 says, "Recall the former days when after you were enlightened, you endured a hard struggle with sufferings, sometimes being publicly exposed to reproach and affliction, and sometimes being partners with those so treated, for you had compassion on those in prison, and you joyfully accepted the plundering of your property, since you knew that you yourselves had a better possession and an abiding one." What a fascinating text. That the powers would come to them, say, "We are taking everything from you, all your earthly possessions, unless you recant of your faith." And they would not, because they had a greater possession that was more true than the possessions in life. So we are to seek God as our treasure. That's what it means to seek the kingdom. And also seek the kingdom, seek the king, seek his righteousness. It means to spend time with God, to be anxious for the things of God. Why do I say that? I'm going to give you two texts. Luke 10, 41 through 42, this is the story of Martha and Mary, where Jesus comes to Martha and Mary's house with the disciples, and Martha starts cooking, and she starts preparing the tables. She's anxious, and Mary's sitting at the feet of Jesus, and Martha says, "Jesus, tell Mary to help me." That's the text. "But the Lord answered her, 'Martha, Martha, you are anxious, merimnao, and troubled about many things, but one thing is necessary. Mary has chosen the good portion, which will not be taken away from her.'" Martha, you're anxious about physical things. Mary is anxious or concerned about spiritual things. That's what Jesus is saying about priorities, to prioritize spiritual things over physical things. Then St. Paul, I'm going to combine that with 2 Corinthians 11, 24 through 28. St. Paul here is describing all of his persecution, all the physical persecution he felt for being an evangelist. And in verse 25 of 2 Corinthians 11, "Five times I received at the hands of the Jews the 40 lashes less one. Three times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. Three times I was shipwrecked. A night and a day I was adrift at sea, on frequent journeys, and dangers from rivers, dangers from robbers, dangers from my own people, dangers from Gentiles, danger in the city, danger in the wilderness, danger at sea, danger from false brothers, and toil and hardship, through many a sleepless night, and hunger and thirst, often without food, and cold and exposure, and here he gives us his greatest challenge. "And apart from other things, there is the daily pressure on me of my anxiety for all the churches." This is the same guy who wrote Philippians 4, where he told us, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus." The same guy who said, "Do not be anxious about anything," now tells us he's anxious about the churches that he had planted. He's anxious for, how are they doing? Are they growing in the Lord? Are they sharing the gospel? Are they growing in unity? So is St. Paul contradicting the command that he gives to not be anxious? No. That "do not be anxious about anything," he said, "do not be anxious about physical things, so that you have room, space in your heart to actually care, be concerned about the things that truly matter." And the other example of this is Philippians 2, 19 through 21, where St. Paul is writing to the church in Philippi, telling them about Timothy. He says, "I hope in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you soon, so that I too may be cheered by news of you, for I have no one like him who will be genuinely concerned, merimnao, for your welfare. For they all seek their own interests, not those of Jesus Christ." So Timothy is concerned for the welfare of the believers in Philippi, and other ministers are only interested in themselves, their own interests, not those of Christ. So how do we care for the interests of Jesus Christ? We care for the interests of his followers. So part of seeking the kingdom of God and his righteousness, seeking, how can I help brothers and sisters be encouraged in the Lord? How can I disciple them? How can I help them grow in their relationship? How can I care for their needs? This is what he's talking about here in seeking the kingdom. "Seek first after the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you." Jesus knows we have other needs. Compare that with Buddha, who says, "Seek first the kingdom, and then you will need none of these things." Jesus didn't say that. He knows we have physical needs, and he's not above those physical needs. Christ's message is life and world affirming, not denying. He says, take care of God's interests, he'll take care of yours. Look after his glory, and he will look after your satisfaction. He'll look after our needs. Your Heavenly Father knows your needs. Does God meet only our needs? No. He will at least meet our needs, but not only our needs. In Philippians, it says, reveal your request to God. Requests are beyond needs. And the psalmist says, delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Sometimes the desires are wrongheaded. The mother of James and John, the wife of Zebedee, Mrs. Zebedee, comes to Jesus Christ, and she's asking, she says, Jesus, give me what I ask for. And Jesus says, what do you want? She says, no, you got to say yes first, and then I'll tell you, just like a child. And Jesus said, okay, what do you want? And she says, let my son sit at your right and your left hand. And Jesus says, you don't know what you're asking for. Can they drink the same cup of suffering that I will drink? And she said, yeah. And Jesus said, okay, they will. And they still can't sit at the right hand. It was a bad deal for them, unfortunately. So she didn't get what she wanted because she didn't even know what she was asking. Sometimes we have desires, and God's like, this isn't going to be a blessing for you. You don't even know. God will always answer your prayers in a way where if you knew everything, you would have prayed for that. You would have asked for that. But there's other places where it's like God gives us way beyond our needs. At the wedding in Cana in Galilee, Mary comes up to Jesus, and she's like, hey, they're out of wine. Is wine a need at a wedding? Is wine a need? It is if there's dancing. You can't have dancing and a dry wedding. You gotta one or the other. It's not a need. It's a blessing. It can be a blessing. So Jesus often gives us more than our need, and as a good father. Finally, in Matthew 6:34, he says, therefore, do not be anxious about tomorrow. That's the focus. For tomorrow will be anxious for itself. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. He's not saying there is no trouble today. He's not saying that. He's saying there is unavoidable worry every single day. Now let's limit the concern for today. Let's not be concerned about today and then also be weighed down with worry and anxiety about tomorrow, because here's the thing, we never live in tomorrow. Tomorrow always becomes today. We always live in today. And Jesus, this is the point of the text, and this is an incredible life hack. Focus on what you need to get done today. Focus on what you need to focus on today. Tomorrow you wake up, you seek the Father, you seek the King, you seek the kingdom, and then focus on what you need to get done. You string those things together, and that's a recipe for a very productive life for God's glory. Philippians 4, 6, and 7, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. So don't worry. The way you fight worry from this text is prayer. Let your requests be known to God. Are we informing God of what he doesn't know? No, of course not. Let your requests be known. Let your needs be known. He already knows your needs, so why are we telling him? We're telling him to get that burden off ourselves. Get that off ourselves. 1 Peter 5, 6, and 7. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. I love the connection between humility and casting our anxieties upon him, our burdens upon him. It's pride that forces us to cling to our anxieties. He says, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God and cast your anxieties upon him. So if you have an anxiety, if you have anxieties in life, and particularly this, do not turn to diversions. He's talking about don't seek diversions. Seek a different direction of your anxiety. Direct them to the Lord. Jesus did not say, look at the ostrich who buries his head in the sand. It doesn't see what's going on. No, Jesus knows we're going to have troubles. He knows that we're going to go through troubles. The text began in Sermon on the Mount, blessed are those who are persecuted for my name's sake. We will go through troubles, but you can go through troubles in a way that doesn't trouble your heart, in a way of peace. Romans 8, 31 and 32, what then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? The God who took care of our greatest problem on the cross, he'll certainly take care of the rest of our problems that we face on a daily basis. He secured our eternity and he will care for us today. I'll close with this. The way we practically fight anxiety and stress and worry on a daily basis, I do it with scripture, and I think it's helpful. I'll give you a few here at the end. When you worry about what people might do to you, remind yourself from Romans 8:31. If God be for us, who can be against us? When you worry about being too weak, recall 2 Corinthians 12:9. My grace is sufficient for you. My power is perfected in weakness. When you worry about future decisions, remember Psalm 32:8. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you. When you worry about whether God will fulfill his promises to you, recall Hebrews 6:18, where it says, it's impossible for God to lie. When you worry about your loved ones, recall Matthew 7:11, how much more will the Father give what is good to those who ask? When you worry about physical sickness, recall Psalm 103:3, he heals all diseases. When you worry about getting old, recall Isaiah 46:4, even to your old age, I shall be the same, and even to your graying years, I shall bear you. And when you worry about falling and failing, recall Philippians 1:6, for I'm confident of this very thing, that he who began a good work in you will perfect it until the day of Christ Jesus. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this great word from the Sermon on the Mount. We thank you, Jesus, for not just speaking this word, but you, the great God of the universe, you are the word for whom through whom all things were created. And when you speak this word into our lives, it's an effectual word. It's a word that can change our heart from being restless to resting in you, from being fearful to being full of faith in you, from being anxious to abiding in you. I pray you give us grace in that. We cast all our burdens upon you. We repent of the pride that it is to play God, to believe that we could do things better. We trust in your sovereignty, we trust in your greatness, and we trust in your goodness and love. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.